Have you ever wondered how major architecture firms deal with new technology? I've always had these questions, you know. How is new software being implemented at large-scale firms? What do they think about AI? Or even some more specific things like, how do these massive offices approach visual communication of projects? You know, renderings and all things visualization.
Well, that's exactly what we're gonna answer in this video. This past month, I met up with Steven from Show Me Better in New York City. And we got to visit BIG NYC. Bjarkle Ingels Group has over 700 people working in multiple locations around the globe. Honestly, they don't need an introduction as you've probably already seen their work. They've got projects of all types and, believe it or not, even on the moon. Bjarkle is what most often is pictured as the face of the firm, but in reality there's so many people and teams involved on what you see being put out. My first contact with BIG was through a series of diagrams I remember seeing back in my first years of architecture school. The NYC office is located in Dumbo, and we were so well received by Kai and the team, it was a blast. We got a huge tour of the office and then sat down to interview one of the partners, Daniel Sandlin. By the way, we divided the interview into two main topics. Steven has also a video on his channel where videos complement each other, so go watch his after this one. And I gotta thank my friend Olly that used to work at BIG NYC, but now has moved to BIG London for making this all possible. Thanks, Olly. We had an incredible conversation with Daniel and we jumped right into what we were most curious about, because BIG has a history of innovating with visual communication. When a decade ago, they started releasing those video explainers with their projects, which at that time was completely new. So we wanted to know how BIG approaches visual communication.
It's a always evolving story. Actually, when I started in 2008, we only had one V-Ray license for the entire office, and I started to kind of play around with it and saw a whole new opportunity to think about the visualization process as a part of the design process. And we try to make sure that everyone here is somehow doing a little bit of everything. We don't like to separate out certain communication tools, because I think as you are developing architecture and design, starting to think about the narrative and the way you communicate it is a way to actually find different ways of looking at your project or your design, and by doing so improve the design. We're working a lot in Rhino. We're doing a lot of test renders throughout the process of the project's design. We're using Enscape a lot. Lumion, a little bit of V-Ray still. I mean, it's less and less somehow. I'm still a V-Ray guy, but I recently got into Enscape and like a whole new universe opened up. A bit of old school in that way. We're always trying to think about our ideas from the perspective of how they are used and how they are experienced. So I think doing visuals and representing your scheme in different ways is like, again, it's like critical to understand the potential of those different spaces. And of course also communicate it to consultants and clients what you're trying to do. So yeah, it's a big part of our process, and we're always trying to find new ways to represent what we're doing.
That's quite refreshing to hear, seeing that these processes overlap even on the initial stages of a project. So interesting. And then while walking around the office, we saw a couple of VR headsets. So we had to ask, what about VR and AR?
Even though it shows a lot of promise, it's still something that have that kind of it lacks a bit of that kind of social aspect. When you look at something together, in the VR world, you kind of go in to your headset and your friends are kind of like, you know, looking at you, and you come out and you're like, did I do something stupid? So I think like that's like what I see kind of the next evolution of like communication, to find that way of creating like a kind of social immersive tools, whatever that might be. VR and AR is definitely there, but it's like how we can get to that kind of social level where you can actually experience something together comfortably without like a million cables and gears.
Note that this was just before Apple released its Apple Vision Pro, which is a big deal, so I'm eager to see how this will impact architectural presentations in the upcoming years. Okay, but what about implementing a new software in the office? Does it come from the top and then all employees must follow some sort of guide, or does it depend on the use? How is new software being implemented at BIG?
Historically, it was mostly an informal process where people came to the office with a certain knowledge or kind of with a certain interest, including myself. When I started, I was really interested in doing visualizations, and we used to outsource it, and then basically we started to do it in-house. In many ways, it's similar with a lot of the tools we're using now, that it starts with somebody kind of have that knowledge or come to the office with that knowledge, and they start to spread that culture around using that tool. But of course, today it's like moving so fast, so you kind of have to be more proactive in kind of engaging different types of tools. So we have a computation team that are now basically kind of scouting for new technologies and new software.
I guess that's one of the many perks of working in a large firm with hundreds of employees, being able to dedicate resources to specific things like this. But I'll let Daniel continue because this is getting even more interesting.
Every time we have the opportunity to incorporate something or whatever tool we use, it needs to be easy to incorporate into like a larger kind of workflow. So the kind of flexibility and the kind of how the tool interact with other software, or how a certain software interact with other software, is for me kind of the biggest kind of possibility and like obstruction when we're adopting new software.
See, a software is a tool. After all, there's no single magical program that will solve all of the architect's needs. And despite the sheer size of the office, I was happy to see that lots of pens and papers were constantly being used as a design tool. Same with physical models. The models were scattered throughout the entire floor, multiple scales of maquettes, 3D printed and handmade. There's even a dedicated space for them, which was one of my favorite parts of the tour. A wall full of 3D printers constantly running and architects fully dedicated to model making. Now, something that stuck to me is that they told us that often BIG's approach to a new design is to literally iterate every single design solution and test it out. Hence, the physical model archive having tons of different solutions. Now comes the most controversial topic of all, AI. Even after understanding that a tool is a tool for them, as it should be, but then BIG being such an innovative firm, we wondered if they already looked into AI and what are their thoughts.
It's somehow a large and very like complex subject, in the sense that like every week there's like a new discovery, it feels like. But yeah, we're using it, we're experimenting a bit with Midjourney as a kind of inspirational tool, I will say. But I see a kind of a near future where hopefully you can use it as a design tool. Obviously it is a very visual tool, so you can come up with things that look cool. But doing architecture is also about kind of transforming an idea to a real building and all the kind of possible constraints that comes with that process. For now, it's something that you don't really get through AI, right? That kind of intelligence to think through how you build things. I mean, imagine in like 5 to 10 years, or even like a couple of years, where you have everything from like artificial intelligence helping you to lay out plans. And I can see also the whole documentation process could probably be automated at some point.
Yes, it's all very new and it will probably change a lot, and it may take a bigger role in our profession than we can imagine. But listen to what he said next.
Like, it is a lot about communicating and collaborating, and there is in like architecture is about building buildings and dealing with a lot of different peoples and a lot of different traits. And I see that as kind of one of the more interesting challenges for AI, to communicate issues or communicate possibilities in a way that a lot of different people can understand it. And it has this interesting effect, right, where you're, in one hand, it's helping you to kind of design, but on the other hand, you're also become a bit detached from your design as well, because you're not forced to figure everything out. But yeah, it's like we're playing around with it like most other people without really knowing where it's going to go. But it's definitely like both exciting and scary at the same time. I think most people feel the same thing.
That's really interesting to hear. Architecture is about people, and AI still cannot replace the human touch. But it's clear that we are yet to find out where we're going to go with this. I hear people from all sides, from the chaotic and dystopian side to the ones that think this will save our generation. Hard to tell. What I can say is that while visiting BIG, it became clear what a diverse space they have, with multidisciplinary people with so many different backgrounds and skill sets, with a range of projects and scales. This has been an incredible opportunity. I gotta thank again the team at BIG for receiving us so well, and appreciate everyone that came up to say hi. It was a pleasure meeting you all. Now, Steven and I had a great time in New York City, and if you've been following us on Instagram, you probably saw all of that. So go follow us on Instagram if you haven't already. And if you enjoyed this type of content, be sure to let me know in the comments below. It's something very different from the usual stuff, but if you guys are interested, I would love to visit some more firms around the world. Now click here to watch the other part of the interview over Shoei Better. It's his own take on the story, and he focuses on the design process at BIG and the office culture. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video.